Thank you. So yeah, I'm here to talk about a build tool that I've made, and I realise that that's a deeply, deeply unsexy subject, and it's something that we talk about a lot, and it's extremely boring. And I'm going to try and hold your attention for the next half an hour or so anyway, and try and persuade you that there is still a bit of room for innovation in the Node.js build tool arena. I'm going to introduce myself first of all. I'm Rich Harris. I'm an interactive journalist at theguardian.com. I found that most people over here know as The Guardian as the Edward Snowden paper. We have a team of interactive journalists who use JavaScript to help tell the news in novel ways. And it was at The Guardian that this project began. It was something that we needed to be able to quickly push our projects out into production. To the extent that I'm known at all in the JavaScript community, it's as the original creator of RactiveJS, which is a UI library kind of similar in use case to React.js, although different in certain important ways. That was also a project that came out of The Guardian. Enough about me. I'm going to give you a little bit of a history lesson before we begin, just to try and set the context a little bit, bring us all onto the same page. Back in the dark ages, we had this thing called Make, part of the GNU project. And Make is basically a language for describing relationships between files. So if you've got a bunch of source files that you need to turn into something that you can distribute, you will have a set of steps that can be described using Make. Now, the trouble with Make is that you can see some of the sample Make code in the back of that screen there, is that it's this crazy moon language that no one's got the patience to learn. And writing a Make file basically looks like this. And it's really hard to write a good Make file. It's really easy to write a terrible Make file. And so for that reason, like, a lot of people just don't want to deal with it, me included. And then fast forward a few decades, and Grunt came out. And Grunt was a real breath of fresh air. It's kind of fashionable to hate on Grunt a little bit these days. But it was and is really, really awesome. Because this is a thing that brought the idea of automation and of saving yourself grunt work to the JavaScript masses, to us lot. And prior to Grunt, there wasn't really anything comparable to Make that we could actually use. And not only was Grunt written in a language that we could all understand, but we all of a sudden had access to the entire NPM ecosystem, which is a wonderful thing. The trouble with Grunt when it's used for these kinds of things, as a lot of people know, is that the configuration files get pretty big. And when I say big, I mean like ginormous. And the builds themselves can get a little bit slow after a while, because Grunt itself doesn't have any particularly smart way to know what files have changed, what files need to be retranspiled, you know, which SAS files need to be converted to CSS, which CoffeeScript files need to be converted to JavaScript. And so you add these layers on, and then you have to manually hook up all of these intermediate directories to get your source files to your destination directory. And it becomes extremely complex. And eventually, these guys said, enough is enough. We're not going to do things that way anymore. And they created Gulp. Gulp is, the idea behind Gulp is that you represent your source files as objects in memory that flow through your code and then kind of get spat out the other end, fully piped and combined and all the rest of it. And they said, we're going to do it with streams. And we were all like, oh, yeah, streams. Because we didn't want to admit that we didn't have a faintest idea what they were talking about. And that seems like a really good idea, right? You're not touching the file system. You've got this code over configuration mentality. Seems pretty good. And then Broccoli came along and said, well, actually, maybe not. What Broccoli came along and discovered is that the abstraction that Gulp necessitates, i.e. turning all of your files into streams, it doesn't always work, because a lot of the compilers that you use when you're building a project like this, they don't understand streams, they understand strings, and they understand files. And so you have to convert back and forth between streams and the file system at various points with a lot of different plugins. And so that complexity, that abstraction, comes at a bit of a cost. Is it worth it? Well, Broccoli says no, it's not worth it, because actually the bulk of the work, the bottleneck when you're doing this stuff, isn't on the file system, the bottleneck is on the CPU. These are very CPU-intensive tasks in a lot of cases. And in any case, disks are really fast these days. And a lot of the time, you won't even touch a disk anyway because of paging files and so on. So Broccoli said, instead of dealing with streams, we're going to deal with the file system directly, but Broccoli is going to make it easier for you. I think that that's the right thing to do, and that's exactly what Broccoli does. And I'll talk a little bit later about why that's so. Before I give you the live demonstration, I just want to emphasize that I'm not saying you shouldn't use any of these tools or that these tools aren't good or any of that. I'm just trying to kind of paint a picture of gradual evolution that's been happening over the last few years that we've all managed to benefit from. And it's a wonderful thing. I'm particularly not saying that you shouldn't use Grunt, because Grunt is great. It's just that Grunt isn't a build tool, contrary to popular belief. Grunt is something else entirely. A build tool is kind of like a chef, right? A chef takes some ingredients and chops them and combines them and cooks them and delivers a delicious meal ready to serve, which is very much like what Gulp or Broccoli or Gobble do. Take the ingredients, your source files, combine them in various ways, pipe them through this process, and serve the end result. Grunt, on the other hand, is kind of more like a butler. A butler can do lots of things. You know, you say, Alfred, take care of my laundry, and he will just make sure that all the various logistical arrangements are made. And he can ask the chef to prepare dinner, but he's not going to prepare dinner himself. Like, he may make a sandwich, but not much more. And so when you read articles comparing Gulp to Grunt and saying that one is better than the other, you have to remember that you're actually comparing apples with oranges to a large degree. So it's demo time. Small caveat, I decided last night that I was going to rewrite it, and that continued today. So I've got no guarantee that this isn't about to blow up in my face, but bear with me, and hopefully it'll all be okay. So I have a sample project here in Sublime Text. So we have a source folder with some assets that we need to turn into our built app. We've got a root folder with some static files that just need to get served. We've got some styles down here with that have various responsibilities. Six files, we want to concatenate those and turn them from SCSS to CSS. And we've also got some coffee scripts up here, which we want to turn into JavaScript. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create my build configuration file, which is called a Gobble file, much like a Grunt file or a Gulp file. And the first thing I'm going to do is require Gobble itself. And I'm going to make things nice and easy to start off. Can you read the text, by the way? I don't need to bump up the size. Okay. A little small? Okay. Is that a bit more like it? Okay, so I'm going to begin by gobbling that root folder, which has those static assets. I save that, and then in my example folder, type gobble to start the build off. Then you can see it's built that. And if I go over to my preview page, we can see that it's serving that HTML. I'll try and bring it over here so that we can. I'll go away so that you can see everything all in one go. Now, this button up here indicates that we've got the live reload extension for Chrome installed and the live reload server is running, and so any changes that I make to my root files should be instantly reflected. Like so. And that's pretty handy. But it's unstyled at the moment. We've just got some Times New Roman text on there, which isn't what we want. So we're going to need to get the styles. So if I update that. Now you'll see that as I'm changing the build definition file itself, the build is restarting. Gobble's recognizing that everything needs to be trashed and started again. So we can see the different files that we've got that correspond to these ones down here. Now the main.scss file imports all the others. So that's the one that we want to take and turn into main.css, which is referenced in our index.html up here. So how do we do that? Well, we call transform. Bear with me a second, I'm going to try and fit all this onto one screen. We're about to write a Gobble plugin. These plugins have a very simple job, which I alluded to earlier, which is to take a directory of files, directory of source files, and turn them into a directory of output files. So we pass in a function that takes an input dir, an output dir, some options and a callback. And what I'm going to do is find the main.scss file. And render it using node.sass, which is a node port of libsass. Are people familiar with node.sass generally? It's a way of transpiling SCSS files or SAS files into CSS. And the API the node.sass exposes is fairly simple. We do sass.render, and then the file, in our case, is path.join input the main.scss. And if we succeed, then we want to take the resulting CSS and write it to the disk. We want to write it to the combination of the output dir, which Gobble supplies to us, and our chosen file name. Write the CSS, and then we call that callback to indicate that Gobble can do whatever it needs to do after that. Right, so this may or may not, I think I've got some extra brackets there. May have forgotten a period. You're quite possibly right. Can anyone see the syntax error? There we go. And then we actually need to export that. This is the danger of doing a live demo. Now, it's telling us that we can't find the node.sass module because we haven't installed it. So before we carry on, I'm going to test the Shutterstock Wi-Fi by installing node.sass. Now, the important thing to see in that plugin is that there isn't any boilerplate. All we're doing is using the stuff that's already built into Node to do some fairly obvious transformations, and there's no mysterious APIs that we've got to learn, there's no documentation that I've got to trawl through. It's all just right there in front of me. I mean, I might need to trawl through the node.sass documentation to understand that API, but the rest of it is just FS, path, and good old node callbacks. So there's really limited opportunity for confusion. And now if we serve the project, we can see that it's been turned into a main.scss file. Up here, you can see that it's actually combined all of the contents there. And if I were to go back to one of these files, say layout, and say text align left, if you look at the top line in the browser, then it will recompile the SAS and it'll reserve that to the browser. All behaves pretty much as you'd expect. Of course, that's not much good without the static files that we need to serve as well, so we're going to do var root equals gobble source dot root, and then at the bottom we're going to create a new node which is the combination of those two nodes. And then if we go back to the root folder, then we have our project with some styles. There is one last thing that we need to add, and that's the JavaScript. But this time, I'm not going to write a plugin from scratch. I'm going to use an existing one. So we'll pull in the coffee script folder and then transform it using the coffee script plugin, which I was kind of hoping wouldn't already be installed, because then I can get to show you something that I quite like. If I delete that, run it again. It recognizes that we want to use the Gobble Coffee plugin, and it isn't installed yet. So rather than make me write require Gobble Coffee and npm install Gobble Coffee and all of that, it'll just do it for me, because it's a computer and computers should do our bidding. That's what they're there for. So while that's going on, it's okay. So it's already installed Gobble Coffee, and it's rebuilt the project. We haven't had to do anything there, and we've now got some coffee scripts in there. And if the stars are aligned, then when I click on the turkey, there is now going to be some interactivity. Apparently not. It would seem that I forgot to include it in the build. So now I'm going to click on it. Excellent. So in a fairly short space of time, we've written a build definition that encapsulates a few different concepts in a fairly concise way. Typically, I've found that a Gobble file is considerably shorter than the equivalent Gulp file or Broccoli file, and so on and so forth. If you'll indulge me on a bit of a digression, I'm going to go off script for a moment, because I've been doing some research recently into source maps. I'm just going to use the proper SAS plugin rather than our bootleg one that we just created. Because now, hopefully, as soon as we install Gobble SAS, obviously, now we're going to get source map support as well. Who here uses source maps? Who here knows what source maps are? Okay, so a few people know what source maps are. It doesn't seem like many people use them. And that doesn't surprise me at all, because source maps are basically impossible to use. What a source map is, it's a file that accompanies the end result of one of these transformations. So you take your CoffeeScript and you turn it into JavaScript. CoffeeScript can actually generate a map which links that generated JavaScript back to the original CoffeeScript. And when you're debugging your code, that means that you get the original line numbers, you get the original variable names, and all of that stuff. And it just makes the process of debugging code much, much, much easier. Fortunately, the source maps themselves are kind of crazy. Now, if we look at the CSS that's being served, we can see that it's actually mapping back to typography.scss and layout.scss. And if we click on these in our DevTools, then we see the original SAS file, not the CSS. And you can tell that it's SAS because we've got things like nested selectors and stuff that you don't get with regular CSS. So that's the power of source maps. It's a really great thing. But as I say, they're really difficult to work with. They assume typically that you're going to be serving your original source content alongside your minified and compressed content. I mean, who does that? Who deploys an app to production and then says, oh, and here are all my source files as well? You know, you just don't do that. And because of that, I don't think we've seen a great deal of adoption with source maps. And there's one major problem which I haven't seen addressed anywhere, and that's that typically these days, you won't just have one transformation, you'll have two. So for example, over here, maybe we don't just have a CoffeeScript transpilation, and I'll just demonstrate that. You can see that it's referring back to app.coffee, and so we can see the original CoffeeScript. It's quite likely that we would have an additional stage to uglify that code for production. And when you do that, the uglify transpiler will generate its source map, mapping the minified code back to what it thinks is the original source. But of course, it's not the original source. The CoffeeScript is the original source. Now, UglifyJS is actually one of the very rare transpilers that is able to ingest a source map from a previous transformation and generate a new one. I haven't seen anyone else really doing that. And so the result is that when you look at the line mappings and so on, when you're trying to debug your code, it points back to this intermediate mishmash which doesn't actually resemble what you originally wrote. So source maps, really clever, and the designers of source maps have done a very good job of making them performant and compact and all the rest of it, but they're actually pretty useless. And the thing is, it doesn't have to be this way, right? There's a mathematical operation that you can do to find any particular part of the generated code where that goes back to the previous step. And then it should be possible, if that step has its own source map, to trace that a step further back. And so I've been working on a project called Sorcery, which tries to do that. And I'm pleased to say that about 1 o'clock last night, I actually got this to work. So if the stars are aligned, then what's about to happen is going to trace the source map all the way back to the CoffeeScript. So even though we're looking at, oh no, we've got to install the plugin again. Even though we've got two transpilation steps in there, it's still going to show the original CoffeeScript. Like so. And to me, that feels like the future. I really hate having to try and work out what the intermediate step corresponds to in my original code. And the tools that we use at The Guardian, we have many, many different transpilation steps. You know, you've got ES6 modules that need to get converted to AMD modules, and then the AMD modules need to get bundled up, and all of that stuff. And it gets pretty crazy pretty quickly. But I'm hoping that this experiment can turn into a real thing, and we can actually start using source maps the way they're intended, and actually make them useful. So I'll just talk very quickly about what's actually going on under the hood here before I go back to the presentation. What the Gobble file is doing, what any build definition is doing with this tool, is creating what's called a directed graph. And the directed graph consists of a number of nodes. A directed graph you might be familiar with is a dependency graph. Like if you require module A and module A requires module B and module A also requires module C, then you'll have, you know, B and C, A, and then your module here. So that's what a directed graph looks like. In our case, we're not talking about modules, we're talking about directories and nodes that have been transformed. So there are three types of nodes in the Gobble directed graph. We've got source nodes, which are things like this. We've got merger nodes, which are things like this, which take a set of other nodes and combine them. And then we've got transformer nodes, which are generated when you take node.transform and change it in some way. And those are the only three primitives that we've got here. And each of those exposes a method called ready, which is responsible for making sure that the previous node, that all of its dependencies are ready, and then saying what its output folder is, where it's written all the files. And the place that it writes all these files to, they're all controlled here, and they've all got nice names that you can very easily recognize. If you looked at the intermediate output of certain other tools, you might find that it's a bit of a struggle to debug what went wrong, because the folder names are completely random and everything. With Gobble, it's all very predictable, so we can look at the UglifyJS and see that this is what UglifyJS generated, and this is the source map that got generated as part of that process. Where was I? So, because of that, it's able to be fairly smart about what are called incremental rebuilds. If we do the build from scratch, then it takes about 206 milliseconds, which is, you know, quick enough. Obviously, it's a very simple project, but it's still reasonably quick. But then, if we were to change something, like say console log, up here, then it recognizes that it doesn't need to recompile all of the SAS and all of that stuff. It just needs to recompile the coffee script and then re-uglify it and then apply that sorcery transformation again, because those are the only things that have actually been invalidated by me changing that file. And so the incremental rebuild only takes 29 milliseconds. And so this is a concept that scales very elegantly. I mean, it works very, very similarly to Broccoli, if anyone's familiar with that. And because of that, you're able to not really worry about the cost of doing incremental rebuilds. You can just keep changing your files and then letting Gobble worry about it, and then live reload will kick in if you want to use live reload. And so you can see your changes reflected almost instantly, no matter how complex your build process is. And that's quite nice. Anyway, back to the presentation. Why did I create Gobble? This is what developing feels like to me a lot of the time these days. There's so much stuff that you need to do, like we've got to deal with module systems and build tools and, you know, Twitter fights about Senver and all of that kind of stuff, long before you actually get to write any code, which is infuriating at times. And I think I know why that happens. I think it's because we developers are a little bit short-sighted sometimes, and we optimize for the wrong things. Typically, we'll optimize for things like performance, because it seems like that's the thing that we should be optimizing for. And my observation is that if you optimize for performance, then you will lose sight of other things that are very important. If you optimize for maintainability, you'll lose sight of other things that are very important. The one thing that forces you to consider all of these things is if you optimize for developer sanity. And what I mean by that is, if you optimize for developer sanity, you're forced to consider performance and the correctness of your programs, unit tests, documentation, all of that stuff, because without it, you'll go insane. But if you optimize for any of those other things, then you will forego developer sanity. And so you end up in a situation where you've got kind of badly designed APIs that can never be changed because they're sort of baked into the way that we do things. And so my message to you is, please optimize for developer sanity. It is the most important thing. A few of the ways that Gobble tries to live up to this principle. So it has things like the auto-installing plugins. I don't want to be NPM installing all over the place if I don't have to. Watching the build definition file as well as the actual source file. Live reload baked in, you don't need to worry about setting that up. graceful error recovery, easy inspecting, like you saw the directories, the intermediate steps, you can easily look at that and see what's going on. And constant feedback about what's going on and whether you've made a mistake of some sort. At this point, people start to say, but it's all well and good, but you don't really have a chance because of this, right? Grunt has been out a while and it's got thousands of plugins. People have put thousands and thousands and thousands of hours into developing plugins for Grunt, and it's got a huge amount of activity on GitHub and so on and so forth. Gulp 2 has a lot of activity on GitHub, not quite as many plugins because, you know, people have already built stuff for Grunt and they don't want to do it again. And then Broccoli comes along, and I think Broccoli is the best build tool that there is, apart from Gobble, obviously. But there aren't very many plugins for it. I mean, there's enough to get the job done for the most part, but it doesn't have as much interest as Gulp and Grunt. And it's not surprising because we get fatigued from having to think about stuff like this. It's not the fun part of being a developer. And then so Gobble comes along. I mean, these stats are out of date now, but it's still a tiny fraction of those others. And so is there really any point? And I call that the ecosystem fallacy, the idea that the value of a tool is defined by the size and quality of its ecosystem. And I'm going to get on to why I think it's fallacious. You're all familiar with the concept of single points of failure, right? It's something that we developers know that we should avoid, and yet, for some reason, we're drawn to single points of failure,
no,
like moths to a flame.
Don't look at the light!
Mosquito to a mosquito trap.
It's so beautiful!
And so periodically, we'll be bitten by one of these single points of failure, and it's like, well, we can't do any work now, so we're going to go and rant about it on Twitter, which is another single point of failure. Now, this one I actually get a little bit upset about because, you know, I think that Twitter is really important. A few years ago, we discovered that this new form of communication had certain really interesting emergent properties. It's actually a pivotal moment in the history of communications. And yet, whereas previous generations of developers at similar moments in history developed open standards, things like HTTP, SMTP, RSS, and so on, with Twitter, we allowed this new medium to be controlled by a single for-profit company that, in a lot of respects, has kind of been a terrible steward of the idea. And there's a real danger that when Twitter crashes and burns, which it inevitably will, it'll take the idea with it. You know, you can't kill an idea, but you can certainly taint it. And that could happen because we haven't developed open standards around it. To be fair, this guy did actually try and develop open standards around Twitter. He is the creator of RSS and podcasting and blogging and various other things. And he saw all of this happening and he said, we need an open standard for tweeting, or microblogging as it used to be called. Unfortunately, he called it lurking, which never caught on because it sounds like a revolting sex act. But thank you for trying, Dave. So my idea is that build tools at the moment are a little bit spoffy. Right, you know, you dive in feet first and like, all these plugins, this huge ecosystem, I can do everything, until the moment when you can't do anything, because the reality is that most build processes will have at least at some point some custom requirements that aren't yet served by the ecosystem. And so if you're kind of depending on other people to supply your tools, tough, you're out of luck. And I had a realization a while ago that this is at odds with other disciplines. You know, the chef sharpens his own knife. Painter cleans their own brushes. The tennis player maintains his own racket. The trombonist lubricates his own slide. But in development, we don't do that. And I wrote an article recently that got quoted on Twitter, and I'll just read out the money quote. In just about every other discipline, craftspeople are expected to maintain their own tools. We programmers have, perhaps uniquely, made it impossible to do that. It's particularly acute when it comes to build tools because almost any build definition above a certain level of complexity will involve some level of customization that's unique to your project. Does that ring true to the people in this room, those who created build processes? Your project is unique, and so you need to be able to build it in a unique way, and our current tools don't let us do that. Anyway, some random internet stranger with a ferret for an avatar decided that he didn't like what I'd just written, and so came back at me and we had a bit of a boring back and forth. And eventually, I let him have the last word. He said this, if your new tool causes you problems, try another or stick with the old. If there is a gap, someone will fill it. And that comment made me really sad. And I couldn't quite put my finger on why it made me sad. But eventually I realized that I think of myself as a creator. And I think of myself as belonging to a community of creative people. These aren't the words of a creator. These are the words of a consumer. These are the words of someone who's become indoctrinated by this idea that you should be able to NPM install all your tools and never have to worry about what they're actually doing. You shouldn't have to read the source code, understand the processes. God forbid you should have to maintain it yourself. But that's the situation that we've kind of been left with. So how do we solve the problem of ecosystem dependence? Well, the first solution is radical simplicity. And that's not just some marketing thing. I mean, I really do think that radical simplicity is what I'm trying to offer with Gobble. We can compare plugins across different tools because they've all had to do the same, they've all had to reinvent the same wheel. And so if you think about Minify and JavaScript, for example, if you were to write a Gulp plugin to Minify JavaScript with Debuggify.js, you're looking at writing about 68 source lines of code. And it's not code that's easy to write. I mean, there's a lot of documentation that you would need to read, examples that you would need to follow, all of that stuff before you got to something that you could actually use. If you use Broccoli instead, it would be a lot better. You'd have 21 source lines of code. And apart from the boilerplate at the top, it's all fairly understandable. It kind of makes sense what's going on here. And so that was a big step forward. The one drawback with this Broccoli filter is that it doesn't support source maps. If you're going to do it with Grunt, 310 source lines of code to minify some JavaScript. This is madness. And I'm not saying that all of those lines of code are bad, or they've been written by people who are bad at programming, or even that those lines of code aren't doing anything. They are, and that's the problem. These lines of code are doing things that I believe should be outside the scope of what one of these plugins should be responsible for. So if you do the same thing with Gobble, it's eight source lines of code, and it's all fairly straightforward. This is actually a lie. I added support for source maps last night, and it's now 9 source lines of code. Now, the really exciting thing for me about being able to do things like this is that it opens the door to other tools being able to use the same format. If we can just come up with the right interface, if we can stress test it and be sure that this is the right way to do one-to-one file transformations in this example, then if someone were to come along and create a new build tool, let's call it Guzzle, then as long as it exposed the same interface, you could use all of the same tools. And Guzzle could be better than Gobble in every conceivable way, and it wouldn't matter because the people who contributed to that community would benefit from the people who contributed to the Gobble community. And then if a third tool came along, that process would accelerate yet further. And so we would truly be collaborating rather than competing in some crazy fashion-driven development war. And there's a name for this, and it's the second plank of the solution. It's called standardization. Standardization you tend to think of as being a fairly formal, stuffy process, but actually, it's what the web was built on. It's how email became a dominant form of communication. It's what we've failed to do with Twitter. And it doesn't have to be a long, drawn-out thing with people sitting around round tables at the W3C. A standard is just any idea that there's two or more implementations of. So if you think about jQuery, Zepto, and Ender, they all expose the dollar function and they all have basically similar APIs. So if you write code to write with jQuery and then realize that you don't need to support old browsers anymore, so you're going to use Zepto instead, most of your code will continue to work, and that's wonderful. Same with underscore and Lodash. Lodash was created because the author of it didn't think that underscore was fast enough. He thought it could be optimized. And so all of your code that you'd written to use with underscore now got faster because someone was using the same standard. That's a wonderful thing. And the same is true of mustache templates, Hogan, Handlebars, and Ractive. They all use the same standard. And because of that, code written for one will often work with the other. We haven't yet applied this idea to build tools, but I think that it's something that we could do, and I think it's something that would save us all a lot of trouble in the long run. So that's the end of the talk. There is a kind of a roadmap for Gobble in my head. I mean, it is still an early stage project. We are using it in production at The Guardian. It is being used in a couple of other places, but there is more to do. And on the roadmap, there's things like being able to use it as this connect middleware. So if you're writing an Express app, you'll be able to use Gobble to serve your front-end assets. But I just want to summarize by saying, please optimize for developer sanity. It is the most important thing when you're writing code that is going to be consumed by other developers. Standards are the answer, not ecosystem dependence. We are a community of creators and not consumers, and we need to behave like it. I would love for you to come and help me build Gobble.
find out where the weak points are so that we can fix them. It's all on github.com/gobble.js. There is a brand new Twitter account which you can follow. And I'm Rich, and thank you. So the chef sharpens his own knife. He's not going to fix his own oven, he's going to get a knife for that. But to the extent that we can, we should try and meet our own needs rather than expecting other people to. Now, yes, it's true that if, you know, there's no point us all reinventing the same wheel over and over again. But sometimes I need a wheel that's slightly differently shaped to yours, and I shouldn't expect someone else to do it differently. So that's what I'm getting at. But I see the point. Yeah.
I really like the point of Gulp, optimizing for developer static, that really spoke to sort of props. There's actually a couple of weeks ago at a conference I ran into another interesting new build system called ASTRS or something like that. And that's an alternative approach to building source maps that you might want to check out.
I definitely will. ASTR.
Yeah. It's developed by some Spanish dude, you know, Barcelona. But and also this Gobble has support for things for like the Gulp equivalent tasks, sort of like different tasks that you can run?
It doesn't. I think that maybe the Gulp task thing was trying to eat Grunt's lunch, and so it has to have a concept of task. Broccoli doesn't have a concept of task. It's all about serving a project and then building it using the same definition. And Gobble is written very much in Broccoli's mold. You know, we have a command line, we have npm run. I don't think that we need another task runner. And actually, Grunt is probably the best task runner that we're going to get. So I use Grunt Gobble. I use Grunt and Gobble together. There's a Grunt Gobble plugin, so you have your build definition that's just kind of inserted into your string task. So once my tests are complete, I'll run Gobble, and then I'll execute my deploy task. This is one of those things that has been done better than I'm going to do it, so I'm going to continue to do it. Really quite nicely. You can have as many different complex nodes encapsulated in a set of files, and you can just require them in like regular node modules. And that's a pretty nice way to break apart some complexity you can tend to get in a very large project. Yes.
I think you were detecting that people were using a plugin that wasn't installed with Gobble. As people create new plugins, do they have to PR plugins, or does it fundamentally suggest that they're on a PM?
No, so the transform string is really just sugar for transform require Gobble string. So if where I use transform sass, what it's saying is that I should require Gobble sass, and then whatever the return value is, use that in place of that string. And so it's all just based on the convention that if you create a plugin, it's Gobble hyphen name.
Awesome. And people suggest npm installing it without.
Yeah, and some people have a weird aversion to that, and that's totally fine. You can just use var sass equal require gobble sass or whatever you want, but it's there for those of us who don't like
having to tell computers to do really obvious things. All right, thank you.